Welcome to this Oscar-themed edition of Razorback Reels. Today we're going to be diving into all things that went down this past weekend. I'm Kai Coacher.
And I'm Yael Evan. Thanks for joining us.
So first up today, we're going to be giving a recap of the winners. Winning Best Picture was Coda, a film about a girl named Ruby who is the only hearing child in her deaf family.
Next up, Best Actor Will Smith, whose other shenanigans will be talked about later, took home the award for Best Actor after his performance in King Richard. While this was not his most memorable moment for the night, it was the first Oscar he's ever won.
Taking home the Best Award for Actress is Jessica Chastain for her role in The Eyes of Tammy Faye. Tammy Faye became famous in the 1970s, and this movie revolves around her climb to fame and the turmoils that comes with it. Chastain's depiction of this character is what brought her home the award.
The blockbuster film Dune also took home a number of awards. The film was nominated in a total of 9 categories and took home 6 of those top titles: Best Cinematography, Best Visual Effects, Best Original Score, Best Film Editing, Best Production Design, and finally, Best Sound.
That was a mouthful. Last up, Billie Eilish and her brothers Finesse won Best Original Song for No Time to Die. This song was created for the most recent addition to the James Bond series. And before we move on from the winners, we have Razorback Reels reporter Maddie Phipps here to talk about the Oscars animation category.
Take it away, Maddie.
The 94th Annual Academy Awards took place this past Sunday, and while the night was full of questionable jokes, surprising wins, and a very interesting performance of We Don't Talk About Bruno, I want to focus on my favorite category at the Oscars, the Academy Award for Best Animated Feature. For those of you who don't know, this category is only 20 years old. Prior to 2002, the Academy didn't think there was enough animated feature films released each year to warrant an entire category. In the case that an animated movie was deemed a masterpiece, it would be considered in other categories. The first animated film to receive an Oscar was Disney's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, which won a special Oscar as it was the first full-length feature animated film. In the following years, other animated movies would also receive special achievement awards for advancing the medium. Disney's Who Framed Roger Rabbit won in 1988, and Pixar's Toy Story received an award in 1995. Prior to the category's creation, one animated film was actually nominated for Best Picture, Disney's Beauty and the Beast in 1991. By the early 2000s, with the rise of competitors against Disney, the Academy finally created a separate category at the 74th Annual Oscars in 2002. For the inaugural year of the award, only 3 movies were nominated: Pixar's Monsters, Inc., Nickelodeon's Jimmy Neutron, and the eventual winner, DreamWorks' Shrek. In 2009, when the nomination spots for Best Picture were increased to 10, Pixar's Up was nominated in both categories, followed the next year by Pixar's Toy Story 3. In the 20-year history of the award, major animation companies have always walked away with numerous Oscars. The frontrunner is Pixar with 11 wins, followed by Disney Animation Studios with 4. Their most recent win, Encanto, happened on Sunday. And while it may seem like Pixar and Disney are dominating the category, every few years an unexpected production company receives the honor. Most recently, Sony Animation won for Into the Spider-Verse in 2018. And animation is a medium, not a genre, and animated movies are not just for kids. That last statement, unfortunately, is something the Academy failed to recognize in Sunday's broadcast. The presenters of this year's award were women who have played live-action adaptations of Disney princesses. And in their speech, they lamented that parents have to suffer through these movies. The statement was especially damaging this year because one of the nominated films in this category was a documentary about a gay Afghan man's story of immigration, which was animated to protect his identity. We can only hope going forward that the Academy apologizes for its statement and begins to value animation as a medium worthy of praise. Though the Academy has many things to worry about after that disastrous Sunday broadcast. That's all I have for you tonight. I'm Maddie Phipps, reporting for Razorback Reels.
Thanks, Maddie. Kai, have you seen any of these animated movies?
You know, I really loved Encanto. That is the one that I've seen. I watched it over Christmas break while I sadly had COVID. But Maribel, just, she reminds me of my middle sister, the middle child. You know, they're always the ones who feel like they're not special enough and they don't get enough attention. And so the whole time I watched it was really just cracking me up because I was like, this is so her. And then I actually, you know, suggested it to her and she was like, yeah, you're not lying. I also love the TikTok trends. You know, we don't talk about Bruno. No, we don't. And then, you know, I also agree with what Maddie had to say when she mentioned the quote that was said that these movies are just for children. They're definitely not. People are definitely not having to suffer through them when they're watching them over and over with kids. All of the movies that were mentioned have all been my favorites at different points in my life. And still, as a 20-year-old today, you know, we spent the majority of the day in the newsroom all talking about these animated films. So, anything that stuck out to you?
You know, I just wish I could get into animated films, but
yeah,
it's really hard. The one animated film I really liked was Moana. I probably should go ahead and watch Encanto, but I'm just like against them for some reason. I just never got into them as a kid.
Fair, I guess. I don't know. I have two younger sisters, so I'm used to watching a lot of animated movies and just enjoying them. Well, coming up next, you can hear all of our opinions on the fashions of the Oscars, the good, the bad, and even the ugly.
Stay tuned after the break, I guess.
When times get dark, we can't see the help that's all around us. Let 211 be your guiding light for help with food, healthcare, and other resources.
211, how can I help you?
Call 211 or visit 211.org. 211, get connected, get help.
My grandfather was part of the study, Alec Ware. And Frank Cooper, just get educated about what went on with the study.
It's just amazing how people still don't know. And now they're comparing it to the COVID-19. It's not a comparison.
Due to the fact that they wasn't given treatments, things have changed now. I've been a nurse since 1981. I just started wanting to do something to give back, you know, after I found out what happened to my great-grandfathers.
And I made the decision that I was going to get the shot. That's the reason I'm doing it. I'm doing it for them. I'm doing it for myself. I'm doing it for my kids.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Worried about your friend, but don't know how to reach out?
You can say how are you or get a fake tattoo. You can ask with an app if it works for you. You can chat with them in VR. It's all good if you think you should check in. Yeah, you should.
Whatever gets you talking.
Reach out to a friend about their mental health.
Whatever gets you talking.
Learn how you can help at seizetheawkward.org.
Hey world, I have a quick message. It's about safe driving. All right, let's go. Anytime you're driving, have the seatbelt buckle tight, both hands on the wheel and your phone out of sight. When not in your hand trying to text somebody back, because if you do, your car might get smacked. The moral of the story, just put your phone down. The people on the road will stay safe and sound. Put your phone down, put your phone down. People on the road will stay safe and sound. Yeah.
See us dream. See us remember. See us protest.
You matter! Your feelings matter! Your identity matters! Everything about who you are matters!
See us fight back.
Bravo.
See us rebuild. See us shatter stereotypes. See us inspire. See us united. See us now.
Got Razorback Reels reporter Riley Atkinson here in studio to give her hits and misses this year.
Riley, take it away.
This past week was everyone's favorite time of the year. No, I'm not talking about spring break. I'm talking about when every social media site and news outlet picks apart the outfits that celebs wore to the Oscars. Okay, maybe that's just my favorite time of the year. But anyways, my name is Riley Atkinson, and today I'm going to take you through some of the best and some of the worst outfits at the Oscars. Now that the unprecedented times have calmed down enough for the Academy Awards to take place this year, I'm sure every designer had countless pent-up ideas on how to rock the red carpet. And I must admit, they did not let us down. But before we get to the jaw droppers, let's give some attention to the mega fails of this year. I caught myself fully laughing out loud at the Travis Barker and Kourtney Kardashian social media attention. I barely saw any comments on their slightly boring monochromatic fit because the main point of attention was Barker's odd stance in the pictures. Honestly, he looks like 5-year-old me when I thought I was really cool after just learning first position at ballet class. Another weak spot came with Tracee Ellis Ross. Don't get me wrong, I absolutely love her, but Cosmopolitan's recap of the night said it best. We aren't sure why she went with some sort of sly Disney branding here. The mouse ear shape in her dress doesn't do it for me. I think the red outfit with curved shapes worked much better in the Best Supporting Actress winner Ariana DeBose's Valentino outfit. All right, now that we've covered Mr. Ballet Stance and Miss Mickey Mouse, let's move on to the good parts. My personal favorite was Lupita Nyong'o. She looked absolutely stunning as she glistened through the night in her Prada gown. Plain and simple explanation, she's just perfect. Now, I have to admit, when I first heard Timothy Chalamet was showing up without a shirt, my face cringed with disappointment at what seemed to be a reckless teenage boy trying to be edgy. Yikes. But to my surprise, he actually rocked the sparkly suit jacket look. I honestly don't think Louis Vuitton can go wrong, so I'll give them credit for pulling this one off. All right, continuing with the wins, social media stars were absolutely killing it at this year's Oscars. Miss Tinks herself showed up in one of my favorite fits of the night, and it was her first Oscars ever. The shape and sparkle of her purple dress flattered her body shape perfectly, and her hair and makeup team worked some glowy magic. Overall, very solid year for Oscars fashion. The sparkly statement outfits definitely won my approval, and at least they got the not-so-satisfying get-ups gave me a good laugh. This has been Riley Atkinson with Razorback Reels.
Thanks, Riley.
My personal favorite outfit from the Oscars was Jessica Alba's. It was this beautiful blue dress, and it had some jewels, and it was sparkles, and I'm someone who I love when it's slim on the top and the dresses just flare, and tulle is probably my favorite material. I hope one day to find this like magnificent tulle dress. What do you think, Kai?
Okay, I have some notes. So I'd like to start with J-Lo. I think she looked like a walking disco ball. You know, I saw the first dress, you know, it's all like the little, they're almost like mirror pieces. I've seen a dress like that before. A girl wore one to my high school prom, and ever since then, I have just fallen in love with those dresses. I think that they're so beautiful, and I hope that I have a reason to wear one day. I also agree with Timothée Chalamet looking just fine without the shirt on. I was also a little bit skeptical about it, but, you know, it wasn't horrible, although I feel like it could be kind of awkward being in a room full of people wearing shirts and you're the one that just has on a jacket. The last one that I wanted to talk about is Lily James, AKA Cinderella. She looked like a pink goddess with her pink dress and shoes. So beautiful. I loved the lace. I loved the pink on pink, everything about it. She just looked angelic. I loved it.
You know, I agree with you. I feel like if anything, Timothy Chalamet is that one person who can come to the Oscars shirtless.
I didn't mind.
Coming up next, what everyone has been waiting for.
We're going to give you a recap on what happened with Will Smith, the fallout, and our takes from the whole situation.
Stay tuned.
Well, now he's about to be caught. Oh, trouble!
As a race car driver for 40 years, I survived a lot of crashes.
Not everyone can run into a wall at 200 miles an hour and walk away. Without a seatbelt, I wouldn't be alive today. Now I'm retired, back home in Arkansas, driving my pickup. I'm shocked how many people aren't wearing seatbelts. Why risk your life when it only takes 2 seconds to buckle up? Take it from number 6. Buckle up, Arkansas.
A message from the Arkansas State Police Highway Safety Office.
hopeless.
I know it was a joke, but it still hurt me.
Because of you, I felt wanted and not alone in this world.
Because you said hi to me on the first day of school, I felt included and I knew that I was going to be okay.
Give your town a reason to celebrate, because every Goodwill item you bring home brings job training and more to your community. Goodwill, bring good home.
Sanjay, you there?
Hey, David.
I'll make this quick. Listen, I have some questions.
What's on your mind?
This vaccine, I'm nervous. I got songs to write. Will I still be able to do that?
It'll be fine, David. Science is what you need. The vaccine is safe, my friend. It's gonna bring this pandemic to an end. See what I did there?
Yeah, okay. I trust it, thanks. Oh, and Sanjay, don't do that again.
David, I don't know. I thought I was spitting fire.
It's Elena Thompson, and I'm here to give a quick recap on what happened with Will Smith this weekend. The slap heard around the world was definitely the most shocking and talked about moment of this year's Oscars. For those of you who don't know what happened, Will Smith slapped Chris Rock on stage after he made a joke at Jada Pinkett Smith's expense. Will Smith then sat back down and yelled at Rock, telling Chris to keep his wife's name out of his mouth. After the awkwardness subsided, the show continued, and Smith was able to accept his award as Best Actor for his role in King Richard. Smith addressed the slap in his speech, apologizing to the Academy, but not directly to Chris Rock. The speech was met with a standing ovation after being met with backlash, saying Smith should have been kicked out. The Academy announced that they did ask him to leave, although some sources claim that he was not asked to leave. Today, I'm joined by a few Razorback Reels reporters, and we want to share our thoughts on the whole situation. Okay, guys, so here are the people I just said I was joined with, and we're just wanting to talk about, like, what happened. Does anybody want to start off on what their opinions are, just in general, with what happened? Ben, starting.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've got a lot of takes on this. First and foremost, how I look at this is, I feel like we were remiss. We didn't mention that Chris Rock made a joke about Jada Pinkett Smith. He said specifically, Jada, love ya. And he said, G.I. Jane, can't wait to see it. Those were the words that elicited an act of physical assault on Chris Rock. And quite frankly, I've never heard a more mild joke reacted to so explosively. Now, Jada Pinkett Smith, yes, does suffer from alopecia, and that is an autoimmune disease that plenty of Americans suffer from, plenty of people around the world suffer from, but my take on it is that's Jada Pinkett Smith's look. We've all known Jada Pinkett Smith for however long. The only thing I knew about Jada Pinkett Smith was that's the girl, she's married to Will Smith. Two, she was in Gotham. I don't know if any of you saw that show. Three, she's the one with the short hair, and that's what I knew her from. And even a week ago, she posted about it saying, I love my head, bald is beautiful, that's why she shaved it. And quite frankly, I just don't understand Will Smith's response. Chris Rock was a man doing his job, hosting the Academy Awards, where people, quite frankly, always get razzed on. it's kind of the name of the game for what the hosts are supposed to do. We've seen Ricky Gervais do this countless times. We saw the other hosts of the night doing it to much more extensive jokes mm-hmm. than the one at Jada. I just think it's unacceptable. It's unacceptable behavior, and the Academy, quite frankly, should have immediately acted, and they didn't, and that's to be expected.
Yeah, I wholeheartedly agree that this was just too strong of a reaction for what happened. Like, her entire, not her entire brand, but a huge part of her personality and her branding is her alopecia. It's not like it's a secret, and it's not like she tries to hide it with any, like, wigs or anything. Like, so I don't understand why it elicited such strong of a response. It also, something that I feel like needs to be noted is that, at least from like the view, like the viewer standpoint, you can see Will Smith laughing at the joke mm-hmm. and then immediately after getting up, you know, smacking Chris Rock and then just like screaming in the audience. And that just seems like crazy. I don't know. It just seems like it was too much of a reaction.
The thing that I have, I guess, to say about all of this is like, I do think that this joke out of all of them was one of the more mild jokes. There was like a 5 minute long, really awful joke about single men, and one of the hosts made a joke about Jacob Elordi being over 18, and I thought that was way worse. Also, the fact that Amy Schumer kicked Kirsten Dunst out of her seat, even though she was a nominee that year, and made a seat filler joke, I thought was also really awful because Kirsten Dunst has faced a lot of issues in Hollywood of being a respected actress.
She was phenomenal.
And she was phenomenal in Power of the Dog. And I just feel like there were a lot worse jokes made that night, but I do know that Chris and there have been other Academy members have said that it wasn't a joke written into the script of the original show, that he did make that joke off kilter. And there's also been a history of him making jokes about Jada before, so I could understand why Will got upset, but I don't know that it warranted a slap. I think that Will could have easily handled the situation by just saying the expletive and just staying in his seat. I honestly think that would have been better, and it still would have gotten a lot of buzz, but he didn't like physically hurt someone. I also think that Will not addressing Chris directly in his speech for Best Actor was, I think, one of the worst parts about this. I watched his Best Actor speech, and the entire time I was just cringing because I was worried he was either going to say something to incite another fight with Chris, or he was going to apologize and it was going to be not heartfelt. And he ended up just saying love makes you do crazy things, and that he apologized to the Academy but not to Chris directly. And I just felt like it took away from a really great moment of him winning his first Oscar. Also, the fact that the category that the slap happened before was the documentary category, and Questlove had this amazing documentary called The Summer of Soul, and his speech just got completely ignored because everyone was just focusing on the fact that Will had just hit Chris. I just think that it took away from a lot of the really great wins that night, and I don't think that the Academy handled it well, and I don't think that Will handled it well either.
That's just kind of what I think too. Like, Will Smith took this like night that could have been great for him, and he just made like everybody not like him for the most part. Like, there are there is some like mild division, but I feel like everybody can kind of agree that like the slap was just too much. Like, it was just like not necessary at all. I don't think. I don't know. Yael, do you have any thoughts?
I mean, I am completely against physical violence. I think it was interesting. And Maddie, you're right. I think he could have fired back with another joke or went on a whole rant. I also think it's interesting he went with a slap and not a punch. I was thinking in my seat, I was like, that is kind of weird. Usually I see people punching, slaps. I don't know. I don't see much of those. So interesting choice of physical violence.
Yeah.
I feel like a large part of this too that is being overlooked is I think nobody should resort to physical violence unless you yourself feel physically intimidated, or not intimidated as much as threatened. If you feel physically threatened, you respond with a physical, things should not get physical to begin with. But there was no justification for this. He told a mild joke, he was met with physical violence. And physical violence is ultimately just the sign of emotional immaturity, maybe even mental immaturity, because if you're not able to come up with a clapback to Chris Rock in your career, you should look into a different outlet. Because, quite frankly, you should be able to think on your toes a little bit better, Will Smith. I don't think He's been in enough comedies to where he should be able to tell a funny joke from time to time. Or at least take a funny joke from time to time. I don't think this joke was necessarily funny, but it's not something to get so worked up about.
Yeah.
Maybe he can join the news business.
Maybe. All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for joining my, or joining, sorry, excuse me, joining this Real Talk. Last up tonight, Kanye L will be rejoining us and be recapping the We Don't Talk About Bruno performance. Keep watching if you want to see what their thoughts are.
Last week, Brandon met a girl on a dating app. One day after work, he finally found the courage to ask her out. No answer. He started to panic. Was he being too pushy? Maybe it was too...
Hey, sorry I didn't respond. I was driving. I would love to go on a date. How does tonight sound?
Brandon tried to play it cool, but inside he knew. A girl so smart, so responsible. She must be a keeper.
COVID-19 has changed how we stomp the yard and feel the beat. Now it's time to take the first step that lets us get back to strolling instead of scrolling. Before we can safely come together, we need the facts. As COVID-19 vaccines become available, you may have questions.
Is it safe?
Should I get it? Is it free?
It's okay to have questions. Now get the facts about COVID-19 vaccines at getvaccineanswers.org so you can make an informed decision for yourself and for your fam.
Listen, you're my friend.
I noticed you haven't really been yourself recently.
Yeah, I feel like something's up.
How are you?
Are you okay?
Is there anything you want to talk about?
I just want to know how you're feeling.
And listen, even if you don't know what to say, I'm here to talk.
No matter what you're going through,
I just want you to know I'm here.
I've got your back. When you want to talk, I'm here.
Today, I'm going to talk to you about physics. Come on in, girls. Let's go. This is the first rocket to get humans to Mars.
Really tall.
I'm a rocket structural engineer, designing and building parts of the rocket. You are the generation that will be stepping foot on Mars. Do I have a group of astronauts on my hands?
Yes.
You can become a rocket scientist or whatever else you want to be.
Unfortunately, Yael and I do not have enough time to continue discussing the Oscars, but we would love to carry on the conversation. So feel free to take your opinions and comments and anything else that you might have to our Razorback Reels Instagram, and that is Razorback_Reels. And also, go ahead and follow us on that social media. I'm Kai Coacher.
And I'm Yael Evan. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.